This presentation is going to cover sandcasting design strategies using FLOW-3D cast. My goal here is going to be to expose you all to some of the comparisons and give you a proposed design workflow on how to use this tool to accurately identify defects related during the filling, solidification, and cooling phases in your sand castings. So a little bit about flow science. Flow science was founded in 1980 by Dr. Tony Hirth, a scientist at Los Alamos National Laboratories. Right now we have users in over 40 countries around the world in multiple industries. Flow science produces two software tools, one being Flow-3D, which is a multi-physics tool. The second being FLOW-3D Cast, which is a computational fluid dynamics software specializing in metal casting simulations. The strength of the tool here is going to be accurately predicting 3D transient flows with free surfaces. This is done using the TrueWAP algorithm, which was developed by Dr. Tony Hirth, and it's a complete suite for all metal casting processes. So to motivate our discussion here, we're going to start out with, why do we use simulations for castings? What is our end goal? We want to produce high-quality, defect-free castings by maximizing yield and reducing scrap, hopefully reducing sample costs and related overall shorten your design process to higher your productivity. Now, this is great, but castings are a really complex process to simulate. You have things such as turbulence, heat transfer, air entrainment and entrapped bubbles during the filling. You can have conductive, convective, and radiative cooling going on. If you're using cores in your mold, you can have core gas evolution and introduce defects due to off-gassing. You can have oxides in your metal fronts. If you are filling things through thin sections of your casting, you have to deal with surface tension. And then also, additionally, on top of all that, you have all your solidification-related defects, so shrinkage, porosity formation, changes in the microstructure, thermal stress evolution during the cooling phase. So how we wrap this all up is we like to put this, make the tool and highlight three elements that we like to give to the user to make them be successful in their simulations. So that's going to be accuracy, ease of use, and versatility. So first off, with accuracy, now the higher the accuracy of the tool, the more useful the tool is. And when you have confidence in your tool being accurate, then you can make informed decisions and design strategies. So this is a low-pressure die casting done by some associates of ours in Italy. And you can see we get some pretty amazing correlation between the simulated defect during the filling and then what they saw on the shop floor. Now, hand in hand with ease, with delivering accuracy is going to be delivering ease of use. Now, today we're going to be looking at the sandcasting workspace. Flow-3D Cast comes with 7 workspaces available. You can do high or low pressure die casting, permanent mold, tilt or centrifugal castings, lost foam, and also low pressure sand casts. So when you select one of these workspaces, this is going to bring up all the sub-process stages that you need, the relevant models that you are going to need, the relevant physics models. This presets process defaults. You're going to preload geometry types and preload material databases that you need for mold and alloy properties. And our whole mindset when designing our user interface is going to be WYSIWYG. This is what you see is what you need. So you don't have a lot of extra information. Depending on your process and the workspace you choose, you'll be able to have a very quick geometry to simulation to post-processing workflow that can help you make easy comparisons. And then lastly, we want the tool to be accurate. We want to have ease of use in the tool, and then the tool has to be versatile. And this, I think, is the biggest strength of Flow-3D Cast, is that the user has full control over the sophistication of the model, and that's in your inputs of your variables and how you want your simulation to run to overall what you want to look at in your simulation. So we break this into three parts. You have a detailed scope. So this is something what I call under a microscope. So just one part of the process that you are trying to optimize to get the best results. So this can be used for preliminary designs, detailed designs, maybe looking at just your gate design or how efficient your risers are working. We'll look at an example of a ladle fill here in a minute. Next to that is going to be your intermediate scope. And this, I would say, is where about 75% of your simulation work is going to take place. This is looking at your overall filling to solidification to cooling. And you can pull from just those simulations tons of information about the nature of your fill, the behavior of your solidification front, and the overall defect analysis you can get out of that is quite powerful. And then lastly, depending on the constraints or the tolerances involved in your casting, you can look at the full modeling scope. And this is the full process from beginning to end in each individual part, and you can piece these together. So example, for a sand casting, you can look at ladle motion and input velocities into your mold. You can look at sand cores. Then you can look at the fill itself and seeing the nature of the fill. You can check gas venting, look at solidification, and then look at cooling and really get a really fine-tuned picture of what this looks like. So here's an example of what I mean by a detailed scope. This is done by Tesco Aluminum at Fiat Chrysler, and this has nothing to do with the mold itself. They're trying to optimize the geometry of a ladle to lower the amount of oxides that are getting introduced into the mold from this point in the process. And so what they did is they looked at four different geometries, and they're outputting turbulent kinetic energy. And this seemed to be a good variable for them to visually and graphically see how much oxides are getting put into this ladle here. And then based on this, they picked the proper geometry to lower the amount of oxides introduced right at the beginning of the pouring stage. So you can look at just this, something very, very detailed. And so here's something a little more intermediate. The output here is going to be oxide formation, but this is where you're getting a visual cue of the overall fill of the part. Are you getting colliding metal fronts? Is there overall turbulence in your mold? How well your risers filling? Are they filling last? Is that oxides getting pulled into the mold, or is it getting left? Into the riser, or is it getting left in the mold itself? And like I said, this is where most of your simulations are going to take place. Filling is something we do extremely accurate and extremely well, as you can see from this video. So let's talk a little bit about model setup before we get into our cases that I want to show you. This is going to be very brief and just kind of give you the bones of the process. Feel free to shoot me an email or send me a message, and I'd be happy to walk you through the interface a little bit more and show you how I set up these models. But the basic workflow here is you first select a material. FLOW-3D Cast comes with a built-in material libraries for alloys and molds. And it's important to note that all of these properties can be customized by the user. So if you're working with a special or exotic alloy that you have proprietary properties for, you can input that into the solver. And also for your material. So depending on maybe what kind of binder you're using, the sort of heat transfer components that you're getting through that, through different type of mold properties, you can test different types of mold compositions. And this is kind of base one. Select your materials for mold and alloy. And next, we're going to select a relevant physics model. So since we've selected the sand casting workspace, we have two choices for the solidification we want to see. So FLOW-3D Cast can identify porosity with two different models. So for your preliminary analysis, we recommend using the simplified solidification model. This doesn't take into account any fluid flow. This is based on liquid region temperatures. You can turn on intergenetic feeding. And we use this for quick results. So for a general overview of just the solidification behavior, how are our thick sections behaving? And then once we have an idea of that and we're happy with our design, then we can move to a principal shrinkage model. I'll highlight both these differences in these models in the cases that we're going to look at. So the principal shrinkage model is going to be based on fluid and heat flow. This does take into account volumetric expansion when you have remelting of material within your mold. This is highly accurate. So it's important to note that both these shrinkage models account for volume changes occurring during solidification, as well as during the cooling of the liquid phase before it begins to solidify. So we do solve for the liquid to liquid change in volume that you'll have during the filling process. So we've selected our materials. We've identified the solidification models we want to use. And then next we're going to bring in our CAD geometry. Within Flow-3D CAST, this is a one-step operation. We have a meshing system called FAVOR. So this is fractional area volume obstacle representation. And this is pretty much you bring in your CAD geometry, you define the bounds of it, you define your cell size based on how computationally intensive you want the process to be or how much detail you want in the part. Maybe if it's in the early stage of design, you'll use a coarser mesh. And as you're getting closer to your final design, you want a finer mesh to really zero in on the details. And then it outputs the geometry that the solver is going to see. So we identify our material, we select our relevant physics, we've uploaded our geometry, and then we have our output selection. So for example, a filling simulation, I like to see entrained air, fluid fraction, fluid temperatures, fluid velocities. I want to look at overall pressures. I'm looking at solid fraction, and then surface defect concentration, which is our marker for oxide formation. So also based on what you see is what you need. You can turn on and off any of these based on where in the process you want it to be. And then Flow-3D CAST comes paired with our post-processing tool called FlowSight. So all the videos you've seen up until now and the rest of the videos you'll see in the presentation were made using this. And this is used to clearly render output data and you make side-by-side comparisons. You have full control of the color scales, and you can make a beautiful output video when you want to make these cases in front of your customer or in front of the rest of your team for why you're making decisions in the design. So let's, now that we've kind of have an idea of some motivation for how we set these models up, we're going to look at a design workflow that I like to use when making a sand casting. And this is an idea called preliminary solidification and porosity prediction. So what this is that we want to look at the solidification behavior of the part and have that introduced and inform our ideas for how we develop a rise and gate and rig the overall casting. So we want to see how the casting develops around thick sections, where are the last places to solidify, are areas of the casting being close to feeding, are fillets and radii working, and are designed for castability. Like I said, we're developing ideas for rigging at this point. And then we're starting to assess risk using the porosity prediction tool that's built into Flow-3D CAST. So here's a quick, it's kind of where we start. So what we've done is we've selected our material, we've selected our mold properties. This is going to be using the simplified solidification model. And we're looking at just the part. So this has no rig. What we've told the solver to do is fill this with metal and then just see how the part solidifies. So just inherently in the part, what are the flaws in the design for castability and what do we have to look out for as we're going to put risers and start gating this. So here we're looking at the overall liquid fraction, which is the visual output of the solidification front, our temperature gradients, and this is our porosity prediction tool. So where we're seeing net defect volume based on just the part itself. So we get a drop here initially based due to gravity, which is usually solved by when we add rigging to the part. We're going to see these thin sections, of course, solidify first out to the rim here and into the hub. And then we're seeing some porosity prediction here in the junctions of the spokes and here in this main hub. So from here, the casting engineer can start to develop ideas on how they're going to neutralize and eliminate these problem areas. So here we're going to start thinking about riser placement and comparison. So we're verify our riser size and location. We're going to ensure that our shrinkage porosity is moved or mitigated. And we really want to make sure that, you know, 101, our risers are the last place to solidify so they can properly feed to the end of the casting. And in FlowSight, we have this thing called context files, and I'll show you what that means. So you can easily put side-by-side design iterations together. And then once we've added our risers, then we're going to start thinking about our runner and gating design. So this is what I mean by context files, is these are the same, two different simulations, but they have the same visual output, and we're looking at the same thing. And this is just a one-click operation. Once we've created this sort of format that we like to see, this can be used across any casting that you have, and it will automatically input and orient these in the way you want to see them. So here's two solutions here. We'll run through these. So this is where I've placed the risers here on the spokes, and when I've placed it on this center hub. And it's pretty interesting to see from this analysis where you want to go. You still see this drop here. We have mitigated a little bit of this porosity, but we're still getting quite a big void here in the middle and here at the spokes. With our larger central riser, the overall solidification is much slower. This is the last place to solidify, and we've really, really had an effect on the amount of porosity that we see in the hub and on these spokes. So we're going to go with this improved solution here and use this as a base to move forward with our design process. So here, we've added gates here, and now we're going to start, after we're happy with our riser placement, the solidification of it, we're going to start filling this part. So two things that I think are really powerful to look at are the free surface defect concentration. So that is the marker for oxide formation in your metal front, and then the overall entrained air volume. So how much turbulence do you have during this filling of this part? And so this is the same simulation with two different visual outputs. And so we can see here we get a good fill from the bottom. To me, this looks very turbulent. There's quite a bit of splashing and sloshing going on. So I think our fill rate is a little too high. But overall, I'm happy with this. We're able to, some oxide formation has moved here, which could be reason for concern. And not too much entrained air. So I believe that the effect of this gating and rigging design is good, but we need to tweak a few more things. And so here we're going to look at our principal shrinkage verification. This is, we've turned on that principal shrinkage model. And so we have the same thing. We're looking at our overall liquid temperatures, and then we're going to output our porosity formation. And so we see the same solidification behavior. We're really able to see this riser is going to feed till the very end. And we're outputting no defect volume. So to me, that's a great marker that this is maybe a design that we can move forward with. Now, as I mentioned before, the filling that we saw was a little turbulent. So I took it one step further, and I wanted to adjust the velocity of that fill. So I've lowered the fill rate here, and also I want to output surface defect concentration. And this is really what's powerful about the tool, is that you're not working within a black box of the mold. You can really see and get an idea for what's happening. So here we can see a very much more even fill. We're getting less turbulence. The metal is filling from the bottom up, which is not introducing any more defects to our mold. Just a little bit of splashing here. And overall, I think this is a much better solution. So that's something that you can relate to the shop floor. So next we're going to look at a turret housing. And we'll follow the same design workflow. And here we've introduced cores, sand cores. And so we have heat transfer components that we've put in between these two. You can look at off-gassing if that's something that you're wanting to identify. This is done in A356 aluminum. And then we're going to look at the same things. We're looking at the overall solidification behavior, the porosity prediction tool, and then our temperature gradients. So let's take a look. So we still get this drop here at the beginning. The thinnest sections are solidifying first. And then as this is solidifying, we're seeing the porosity happen where these places are getting closed off to feeding. So what I'm going to try and do is place these risers right on top of these areas and see if we can mitigate that porosity. So here's our riser comparison. And so I went ahead and added a gating design that I think would be sufficient. And this is what I mean about open workflow. This doesn't have to be done in steps. I've added my rigging. If you want to do a filling first, that's totally up to the prerogative of the design user, of the design and the user. So here we've added these risers here on top of those sections of porosity, some with a smaller diameter and a little bit larger. I think it's pretty interesting to see, you know, how we can move that porosity into to it and mitigate that. So with the smaller diameter, we are seeing some porosity form on the surface of the casting and almost maybe into the casting a little bit. The larger diameter, we're able to move that porosity up into the riser. And these are both solidifying glass, so I'm happy with that. But this is from our simulation, the design we want to move forward with, the simulation on the right. And so now we want to fill these things. So maybe at this point we have some questions. We're happy with the risers and the placement and how they're behaving. But now we want to look at differences in air entrainment. And I like the simulation because you can easily see these are three different design iterations. We're going to fill these from here, our initial design. This where we've moved the rig by 90 degrees. And this is with a single sprue with double risers gating into the system. And we're outputting in trained air volume. And so still with this design, you know, based with these opposed two filling points, you're going to have converging metal fronts, which is going to add turbulence. So maybe that's something to think about and look at. But visually, you can see the amount of turbulence based on the entrained air volume. The single sprues has quite a bit. It's mitigated a little bit by having these opposed across this part here. But our initial design is still behaving the best. So we're still going to move forward with this design here. And just to showcase a little more functionality of the tool, we're going to look at free surface defect concentration. And I've added here on the gates flux surfaces. So I put tracers so I can see when this metal inputs into my part, into the mold, where it ends up from each individual gate. And this may be getting into more, a little more of the detailed design, but this is something you want to analyze and further give you a better direction of what's happening. Something. So the last case we're going to look at is a V8 crankshaft. And this is a little more of a complex part, different thin to thick sections. It might not be as intuitive with this how it's going to solidify. So we're going to start off with this preliminary solidification, looking at the same criteria. We're looking at the liquid fraction, the solidification front, our porosity prediction tool, and the overall temperature gradients. And so as we see as it solidifies from the outside in, we're seeing quite a bit of porosity on the edges of these fins here, and that's due to the solidification and the way this part is laid out that's closing off feeding to those sections. So next, what we want to look at is we wanted to design this in a tree. So here I'm looking at the verification of my gating design and done this with a single sprue and a stepped riser system into gates. And this is a great way you can see the, how powerful this tool is. You can get a visual cue of are you filling these things individually so we can get proper heat transfer going on. You can visually see our risers are filling last. And you get this amazingly accurate and realistic view of your overall geometry and ratios during your initial design. And so lastly, with this case, just to showcase a little more functionality tools, we've going to look at that principal shrinkage model with our porosity prediction with heat controls. And so here we've added functionality of riser sleeves and different types of gray iron chills. So we want to look at these fin chills here and their placement, or the ring chills on the end here. And then up here we're looking at our preliminary solidification results to see if we've moved or mitigated that porosity. And so here with these ring chills, you can see that we have moved the porosity away from the end, but into the part a little bit. And then with the fin chills, we're seeing much less porosity formation. We've definitely moved it away from the edge. And then based on your product specifications and your tolerances, this could be an effect that you want to go for. So it's interesting to note that, you know, these are just some design strategies. There's plenty of ways that you can rig and create these to make successful castings. And using this tool will help you inform that design process. You know, if you have any questions about why I made decisions, feel free to shoot me an email, and I'll be happy to walk you through some of the design iterations and the graphical user interface. So hopefully, in during this presentation, I've shown that Flow 3D Cast can quickly adjust and rerun design iterations by easily uploading new geometry to a simulation. You can accurately identify porosity and shrinkage volumes within a casting. Have extremely clear analysis of the filling behaviors during air entrainment, turbulence, and oxidation. And you can easily verify design criteria with intuitive post-processing. So lastly, to wrap up here, this is a quote by Richard Emmerich, who's now a retired senior metallurgical development engineer at Metaltech International. And we're engineers here at Flow Science, and we create this tool so engineers can use it to be successful. And he says, "I've personally modeled the filling, solidification, and cooling of countless castings, with the goal being to maximize metal cleanliness and soundness to control grain structure, segregation, and stress-related defects. They have a great deal of success using Flow 3D Cast to predict casting performance, to optimize quality, and reduce cost by reducing rework, scrap, and lead time." And to me, that sums it up right there. Metaltech uses this across multiple manufacturing and casting processes, centrifugal, gravity casting, and they're able to have success using our tool. So that will be it for my presentation today. Thank you guys for taking the time to take a view at this. I hope it's given you some ideas and hopefully some questions. So please feel free to reach out to me, ajit.dabras@flow3d.com. I'd be happy to learn about the processes and some of the problems you're facing in your shop and seeing if we have a good solution for helping you become a more productive casting shop. Thanks so much. Take care.